was interested to read in the news this week that a blindness cure is one step closer after scientists replace the lost light-sensitive cells in the back of the eye, from the Daily Mail reporter on Wednesday. And certainly blindness is a terrible predicament to be in as a human being. But there are other kinds of blindnesses, are there not? One of the kinds of blindness that we encounter in our daily lives is when we're so focused on what we think is the main problem that we become paralyzed. Our scripture today will give us some insight into how to open our eyes and see in a different way. And I invite you to join me on this journey this morning as we open our ears and our minds and hearts to the gospel according to Luke from chapter 24. Listen for what the Spirit is saying to the church. Jesus himself stood among the disciples and said to them, "Peace be with you." They were startled and terrified and thought that they were seeing a ghost. He said to them, "Why are you frightened, and why do doubts arise in your hearts? Look at my hands and my feet. See that it is I myself. Touch me and see, for a ghost does not have flesh and bones as you see that I have." And when he had said this, he showed them his hands and his feet. While in their joy they were disbelieving and still wondering, he said to them, "Have you anything here to eat?" They gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it and ate it in their presence. Then he said to them, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms must be fulfilled." Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures, and he said to them, "Thus it is written that the Messiah is to suffer and to rise from the dead on the third day, and that repentance and forgiveness of sins is to be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things." The word of the Lord for us today. Thanks be to God. In silence, let us pray to the Lord. Amen. There's been a change in the last 10 years or so. Perhaps you've noticed it. Our lives are full of screens. If we're at home, we're sitting usually in front of a television screen or a computer screen. If we're at work, we're probably in front of a computer screen. In our cars, we have screens on the dashboard. As we walk around in our daily lives, we have screens on our cell phones. Everywhere we go, we have these screens. And the amazing thing about the screens is that they're connected with what seems to be all the information in the world. A new development in the last 10 years or so, but which has come to such a point that you take a Maasai warrior in Kenya, standing there in his traditional garb that they've worn for hundreds of years, with a smartphone in his hand, has access to more information than the President of the United States had 15 years ago. Yet, do we really see and what do we really know? The disciples of Jesus, after his death, were not sure exactly what to believe. They had seen with their eyes his death. And in our story today, they see with their eyes his appearance after his resurrection. And they're not quite sure what to make of it. And therefore, Jesus, when he appears to them, the first thing he says is, "Peace be with you." Because they were startled. They were terrified. They thought they were seeing a ghost. He said to them, "Why are you frightened? Why do you have doubts arising in your hearts? Look at my hands, look at my feet, the nail scars." Reminded of a man who had been in a terrible motorcycle accident, was in the hospital, and he had finally recovered enough to get up, on his walk or make his first trip down to the general store in the hospital on the first floor. And he's standing there, and a little child, about 7 years old, comes up to him and sees all the bandages and scars on his body and says to him, the little boy says, "I fell and cut my head and I had to get 8 stitches in the back of my head." And the man who'd been in a motorcycle accident said, "I was in a motorcycle accident. I had to get stitches all the way down my arm and across my face and across my chest and all the way down my leg to the floor." And the little boy said, "Yeah, but mine really hurt." It's interesting to see in our passage today this emphasis on the nail-scarred hands of Jesus. The suffering of Jesus as a human being, and yet his appearance as a spirit, as a ghost. What are we to make of that? Well, let's skip that for now. We'll come back to it later. Jesus ends this encounter with the disciples by saying to them, "You are witnesses of these things." And I would say to you that you are witnesses of these things. You have seen the resurrected Christ. Did you know it? Did you recognize him? After the worship service in the sanctuary, there's a lady sitting in one of the back pews with her head down, weeping, and gathered around her is a group of women who are putting their hands on her and praying for her and being with her and supporting her because she's just found out that week that she's been diagnosed with terminal cancer. And there in that gathered group of women around this one woman for whom they're praying, there we see the risen Christ in human form. A pastor friend told me about a Tanzanian woman in his congregation. Her mother, who lived in India, had died, and she was going to have to travel there for the funeral. Before she left the city, he wanted to go and see her and have prayer with her. And so he went to her apartment, he knocked on the door, she opened the door, he walked in, And there sitting in her living room in the apartment were 12 women. 12 women gathered singing in hymns in the Swahili language, their home language. And he looked around and he thought, what do they need me for? She has the support that she needs right here. And he said, in those gathered women singing in Swahili the hymns in support of this woman, there I saw the risen Christ in human form. Not too many years ago, there was a terrible hurricane, Katrina, as you recall, that struck the city of New Orleans and all across the Gulf Coast through Mississippi. And so Presbyterian Disaster Assistance was quick to respond, sending volunteers down there. And there was one particular older couple who went down as volunteers for Presbyterian Disaster Assistance. And they were assigned to this house in Goshen, Mississippi, out in the middle of nowhere. And so they showed up that day. They worked all day. They helped them muck out the house, make it more livable. And when they were finished, they could tell the couple who lived there, again an older couple, were very appreciative. And so they showed them their work order for that week and said, could you look on here and see where we're supposed to go tomorrow and tell us in general where that is, because we're not sure how to get there. And the older couple looked at that work order and they looked at one another and began to cry. And they said, according to this work order, you weren't supposed to be here today. Our address is not on this paper. But we know that God sent you here today, because last night we had reached the end of our rope and we had come to the decision that unless something happened today to give us some encouragement, that was it. That's all we could take. We were going to clean out our medicine cabinet and we were going to take our lives. And then this morning, you showed up and you cleaned out our house. That older couple working for Presbyterian Disaster Assistance, there is the risen Christ in human form. Jesus is with us today, present in this sanctuary. And the message he has for us is the same message he has for his disciples. We who are a little bit unsure, we who are a little bit worried about the way things are going in the world, we're caught up in whatever problem it is that we're facing in our lives. We can't seem to get over it. It's just like a rock in the middle of the road that we can't get around. And Jesus comes to us and he says, peace be with you. Peace be with you. Because he knows that there's a way around. I was reading this week a great book by Daniel Burris called Flash Foresight, in which he recommends that we take the biggest problem that we face and skip it. Just skip it. For instance, after he gave this speech, take your biggest problem and skip it. A little crowd gathered down here. He went to speak to them. They were going to say, here's my problem. How could I possibly skip this? And there was a woman who waited to the very end. He could tell she had something very heavy on her heart. And she told him, listen, I was diagnosed with terminal cancer, and I've got 30 days to live. That's my problem. How do you recommend I skip it? And so Daniel Burris told her, I'm sorry to hear that, and that's an unbelievable problem to face. But I wonder if instead of focusing every day on your looming death, if you could just save that, if you could just skip it until the last day when you're going to die, and then on that day you deal with that. But in the meantime, focus on your life, the life you do have to live, the last few days. How do you want to live it? And he heard back from the woman about a month later and said, that made a huge difference in my whole perception, in my whole perspective. Thank you. Thank you for giving me my last few days of life back. You may remember Natalie Cole, the great singer. She sang once with her dad, Nat King Cole, when she was a child. But it wasn't until she was in her 20s when she really got her own career going in the music industry. And she really had a dream if she could only sing with her father, sing a duet. But she had a problem. Her father had been dead for 10 years. So how are you going to sing a duet with him? Some new technology came out in the music industry whereby they could digitally take splices of this and that and put them in a new song. And so she went and talked to her manager. And it turned out, well, actually, we could try this. And so they did try it, and she produced a whole album called Unforgettable, where she sang duets with her father. She took that problem and she skipped it and found another solution. I want you to think about that in your own life this week. Whatever it is you're facing, whatever it is that is wearing you out, bringing you down, skip it. Not to make little of what you face, but just to show you that it's like an onion with all these different layers on it. Once you get past what's holding you up, you can start peeling back the layers of the onion and see that there's a lot of different aspects to what the real issue is. And you get some insight that you couldn't get before. I see this being played out in this church this year. We started the year out, our big problem, our big concern, lack of money. Lack of money. Can't think of anything but that. But the session decided, hey, let's skip it and move on and see what happens. And what has happened? Well, we don't have any money, but we have a brand new remodeled educational wing over here. Beautiful. Go look at it. Got tile floors, paint in every room, new carpet. God had a way of working around that and making that happen. Well, we don't have any money, but we're talking right now to some partners, some collaborators, Presbyterian Children's Home and the Home Aid Association of the Houston Builders Group, about the possibility of building four duplexes on the land that we have between here and the Methodist Church Total cost, I don't know, maybe $1 million. It's not going to cost us a dime. There's power in this truth. Put it to use in your personal life. Take your biggest problem and skip it and see what God will do.